And 2 Timothy again says, yes, and all who desire to live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution, but evil men and imposters will grow worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived. You know, a lot of people today are wondering what is happening to the world. A lot of people that we know are addicted to drugs. Families are falling apart. We're on the verge of war. We're worrying about our money. We're worrying about our savings. We're worrying about all these things. And as I've been praying this week, I ask God, what is the problem? If you go to this church, you'll know that a few weeks ago, the Lord dealt with me on that men in the last days, same book, same chapter, says this. Know this, that in the last days, perilous times shall come. For men, this is 2 Timothy 3:1, if you want to read along, and it says, for men will be lovers of themselves. They're going to be lovers of money. They're going to be boasters. They're going to be proud. They're blasphemers. They're disobedient to parents. They're unthankful. They're unholy. They're unloving. They're unforgiving. They're slanderers without self-control. They're brutal, despisers of good, traitors, headstrong, haughty, lovers of pleasures rather than lovers of God, having a form of godliness but denying its power, and from such people turn away. Fair warning, if you've never heard me preach, I do get excited when I start talking about Jesus Christ. Now, he's telling you here that these things are going to happen in the last days. Why are these things happening? And the Lord led me to this scripture. Because we are deceived and we're being deceived. I'm going to say that again. We are deceiving and being deceived. I say unto you today that man believes that he is going to solve the drug addict's problem by passing another law. He believes that if we lock everybody up, they will stop doing heroin, and they've been doing this since 1971, and it has not worked. And this is a big concern that I'm called on many times through the week. What is it that we need to fix this problem? So man says, I'll pass another law. Man says, I'll build a new prison. Man says that I'm going to do it my way, and it's failing, and we're still committing the same insanity we've been doing for over 100 years. I say unto you today that the church needs Jesus Christ. The people in the church need to get right with Christ, and the people need to stop saying they can do it yourself. You cannot do this by yourself, church. I want to tell you that after World War II, do you know why this country was so great? I know some of you in here know exactly why it was great, but I'm going to tell the youth today that are my age, the reason that it was so great is you had praying moms and dads, praying grandmas and grandpas. You had people praying and serving and raising their kids in the admonition of Jesus Christ. I doubt that any of you lived a more hellish life than I did during the 80s. And my mom's prayers is why I stand before you preaching today. It was my grandma and my grandpa, you know, never giving up and leading me to the knowledge of Christ. And at 26 years old, I went and bowed on my knees and gave my life to Christ. Why? Because I was raised to know the fear of God. Today, we are taking man's wisdom and trying to solve the problems of the world. It's never going to happen. You've got people that are deceived and positions of power, and they are trying to lead by deception. By deception, church. Somebody this week said we had a big meeting. We decided that we're going to fix all the problems of the drugs. Most of you know my wife is an RN. She spends a lot of time dealing with this problem. Their answer is, let's do this. Let's put all the drug dealers in jail. I let them go on. And then we'll do this. And I said, we've been doing this forever. It doesn't work. Why? Why doesn't it work? You have no power over this enemy in your life without Christ. Well, how long is man going to live without any power? That's what he says here. In the last days, they'll have a form of what? Godliness, and deny the power of being godly. I say to you that Jesus delivered me from who I was. Jesus can deliver the alcoholic. Jesus can deliver the heroin addict. Jesus can deliver the crack addict. Jesus can do it. Not you. Not another program. Not another plan. I say unto you, I used to, when I was at the church on the hill, we had Celebrate Recovery, which was a drug addiction program that we used to try to get people at that time off of crack. And you know that people would show up and say, oh, this ain't what I thought it was. I thought this was going to be like another program where you're going to talk about me getting through this problem without God. You cannot get over your sin without God. You cannot get over anything in your life without Jesus Christ. This is the deception that man is living today. It is the deception. The deception is I can do it myself. I don't need God. I don't need Jesus. I don't need his power. I don't need his teachings. I don't need his ways. And so what has happened to us is we are now have these problems that are so massive and overwhelming that we are now going to turn to ourselves again and wonder why it's not working. I say to you that a lot of men have done a lot of things trying to fix what ails this country, but they want to do it without God. In the 1850s is when humanism came around, and we decided that we don't need God no more. We're too smart. We're too smart. And so now we're going to do it on our own, and now this is the mess we're in. This is the mess we're in. The schools don't need to talk about Christ no more. When in the 1970s, I'm from the head of a holler in Hazard, Kentucky. And I can tell you this, in the early 70s and 1969, 70, 71, around there, the first thing we started was the Word of God, first thing, in the school. Do you know what Yale, Harvard, and Princeton was started? So you can learn the Bible. Now they've thrown him out and wonder why we're in such a mess. You're going to stay in a mess till you get on your hands and knees and repent and give your life to Christ. It's never going to get any better. I don't care who you elect president. I don't care who you elect as governor. I don't care who is in the Congress. If the hearts of the people are wicked, it will be wicked. It's that simple. Do you not know the founding fathers said this? Do you not know that Benjamin Franklin said that without morality, this will never work? Do you not know he said that? Do you not know that George Washington went to the church in New York City that on 9/11 was the only building left standing on that block? How many knows that? That church. And he went in there and made a covenant with God in the house of God that we would serve God. George Washington. Now they're trying to eradicate all these things out of our country and say that didn't happen. Didn't happen. Didn't happen, see? You know, modern medicine has caused us also not to pray. I'm sorry, church, I'm a sick man. But I'm telling you right now, this drove me to prayer. Because I'm so sick sometimes, I don't even want to get out of bed. But it drives us to prayer. But modern medicine says, just like when my friend Diane was just dying in the hospital, and the doctor comes in, and they said, well, the scarring from the radiation now is going to cause her to die. And she goes, all we're trying to do is keep her comfortable. That's what we're trying to do. Are you getting what I'm trying to tell you? I'm trying to tell you that living without God and Christ in your life and the nation and your city is not going to work. You can pass any law you want, it won't work. How do you remove a desire except with God? How do we do this? And so now we have churches. I'm sorry to be preaching this hard. I know we got visitors, but I feel this. Why is it that churches promote self-love? Churches, hear what I'm telling you. They are in love with themselves. You hear them stand in the pulpit. What's wrong with you is you don't like yourself. The Bible says that if you do not hate yourself, you cannot be my disciple, Jesus says. But we preach that you need to love yourself. You're the most important person. No matter who you destroy, chasing your dream, chasing your lust in your flesh, no matter who you harm, go ahead and do it. Go ahead and do it. Jesus says no. I say unto you today that if you want to be the greatest, you must be servant of all. And we don't want to serve because we are following these doctrines that's come out of hell. Lovers of money. I've already preached on this and told you how it tied in with Revelation. But you got to admit that the love of money is promoted in the house of God. In the house of God, church. The Bible says turn away from this. We got people sitting in the church that love God that may be totally financially destitute, and they are in love with God. But who runs the church? The filthy rich people. I'm sorry, I made you mad. Can't help myself. Is that not the truth? I did study, most of you know I'm an absolute nerd when it comes to studying. They did an absolute study on churches, and they said that on the average, if a rich man comes to the church, he will be running that church in 90 days. Jesus would be thrown out in the gutter if he showed up at most churches. Why? Because he had no place to live. He had no money. But this is where we went. Now, how did this happen? Because it's just the same sin of Cain. Cain says, I'm going to plow the field. I'm going to do it my way. And then I'm going to appear before God and bring him all the fruits of my labor and say, here you go. You're going to accept that. God says, I reject that, Cain. And Abel brought a little lamb that he didn't have to do anything to. It was a brand new baby. And he brings it to you. Here you go, Lord. I don't know what I could do. I don't know what I'm doing. Jesus says, when you say you can see, you're blind. But if you say, I'm not sure what we should do, God, I need your help. Jesus says, you can see. Now you can see. When you need go to God for help, Jesus is saying, I see. You see. See, you must realize you need his help. You need his power, and he is the Spirit of God convicts souls. While the whole world, here's what they would come in and tell me, if you quit doing drugs, smoking, and drinking, Wayne, and get right with God, every day, you not know my family's religious. My dad owned that gas station, and it was constant bombardment from people telling me how I should live in the 80s. Didn't receive one any of that. But my mom loaned me some Bible tapes in 1992, and I'm cruising down the road at my job. And the next thing you know, by the time I got to Exodus, I was ready to get right with God. And you're saying, why? Because I realized what God had done for the children of Israel. And I said, Lord, I wouldn't do that to you. And of course, I already had, because I didn't understand. Because the church I went to had laws to fix a problem. I'm not picking on my church I was raised in. I'm just telling you the truth. How many knows that some of the churches had laws to fix a problem? Did it work? I ask you today, did it work? No, Paul says law don't work. He's told you that over and over. We don't want to hear it. We don't want to hear that we need something besides ourselves to fix a problem. Do you not know the laws that were gave on Mount Sinai was to prove to you that you cannot live right with God? All 613 of them. We get mad because 10 of them ain't posted at the courthouse. There's 613 laws, not 10. That's just the highlights of it. The Bible says all laws fall into this. Love God with all your heart, soul, strength, mind. And love your neighbor as yourself. Can you all follow that? That's easy to follow, isn't it? But no. No. We don't want to love God with all our heart, soul, strength, and mind because we're in the age of man. Man. We know what's best. The school system says they know what's best. Don't they? Taking God out of the school and the kids are insane. I'm sorry, church. I have 4 kids and 2 stepkids. I don't know what I'm talking about. Are they not? They're doing unreasonable things. Why? Why are they doing these things? Deceiving spirits. Deceiving spirits. Even the parents, you've raised your kids to the admonition of the Lord, and they still go off. You don't understand what just went wrong. Because deceiving spirits all around the place. You got people puking in their brain. Telling them to live by your own way. Live without God. Follow me and I'll lead you to the pit. But they're not telling you the end result, do they? I like it how the promotion of free sex is, but they don't deal with the unwanted pregnancy, do they? So how does man deal with that? We'll kill it. That's how we'll deal with that. We'll kill it. That'll be the way to do it. Instead of telling the children, stop searing your conscience. I tell girls this, and I'm sorry this is offensive. Don't give him anything till he's married to you. Do you understand? I had a big youth group one time. There's 38 people in there, and I told the pastor in advance, this is going to flip you out, what I'm about ready to say. And I got up and told those kids, I said, if you want these boys to start acting right, stop putting out. They were like, this is what's wrong. See, they have told women and turned you into objects. And you want to know why the man comes and abuses your daughter, and when he's done with his new idol, he sets her on the shelf. See, all these Hollywood people give you that women are idols. Well, listen, ladies, the great worst thing about an idol is what do you do when you're done with it? You put it away. I say unto you, to have that precious woman will cost you the rest of your life. Because see, Jesus Christ gave his life for you, his wife. And a man is to give his life for his wife. And when you treat her like a harlot, you treat her like Satan did Jesus' wife. That's a deep secret. It's the mystery of the bride of Christ. And this is why we need to, as a church, as a city, as a county, as a nation, to turn back to God. Say, God, I want you involved in my school. I want you involved in my church. I want you involved in my kids' lives. I want you involved in every aspect of our government. When William Penn came to this country in the 17th century, he wanted to start a Christian city. And that city is called Philadelphia. And the Constitution you have and the Bill of Rights you have came from that man and those people that were trying to live godly. But do you know, in 12 years, he was being sued over that land. That's how the devil works. And so he's over fighting and trying to save this property because his dad was an admiral, and the king owed him a fortune. And everybody in history will tell you that what the king gave William Penn was not even right. But he accepted it because they wanted to escape religious persecution. So they come here and start this, and do you know, 12 years, all the filth that they tried to get rid of in London was here in America in just 12 years. You're saying, how does this happen? Because people that are deceived had to move into the town, and while everybody is chasing trying to make money, the devil took over the city. I'm sorry, look this up. You can study this. I say unto you today that this town has some problems. And the next council meeting of churches, maybe the last one I get to go to, because I want to stand up and tell them we need to pray in church. This is spiritual war. This is how we end this problem in this town. It's by prayer. Us sticking together. God is bigger than these problems. Is he not? Is he not? Have we lost all faith? I'm going to close with this. You know, I feel like preaching this morning. But I'm going to close with this. There was a battle in World War II called the Battle of Bastogne. Now, there's a show called Band of Brothers. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Anybody into war movies? Excellent show. Okay? Got some racy parts towards the end, whatever. Just fast forward it. But it was a very good movie. It's Spielberg and Hanks. They made another one called Pacific. But they show barely this. They show them praying at the Battle of Bastogne, but it's like five or six guys. You know what the reality of this makes me sick? This really makes me mad when they twist what actually happened. because Patton called up the United States chaplain. And he's standing there next to Patton. And Patton says, we're losing the battle over at the stone. And he says, listen, preacher, I want you to go get on your face before God. And he said, I was scared to death. Here's his two pearl handle pistols. He said, I knew this man was going to shoot me dead. So he went and started praying. He says, God, you know this man's going to kill me if I don't come out of this prayer closet and tell them how we're going to get over this battle. So he said, the only thing that come to his mind, I want you to tell the general to go ahead and print up so many thousands and thousands of these brochures and say on a certain day at a certain time, we're going to pray. And so they flew over. They couldn't see because of the clouds that was covering the battlefield. And these brochures came flying down. And all the men knew that at a certain time, it was time to get on your hands and knees and pray. And they started praying. And before their eyes, the clouds cleared. And we won that battle. That's because we prayed. The French city, and I can't remember the name of it. Then they were all going to die. One preacher in town said, let's get on our face and pray. And the clouds covered it. And the Nazis never bombed one thing. That's because they put their trust in God. I'm sorry, church, I don't want to offend you, but it's God that we need in our lives. It's God that we need in our families. It's God we need in our schools. It's God we need in the council. It's God we need in the lighthouse. It's God we need in the Congress. It is God that will fix these problems. God. God. Not man. Everything we're doing has been wrong. How many knows what I'm talking about? Is it working? I told somebody the other day, why continue this insanity that doesn't work? You're convinced it's working, it's never worked. It didn't work then, it's not going to work now. It's not going to work in the future, it's never going to work. It's never going to work. We need God. You know, the people during that time were very honorable people. And those people from that generation, I'm sorry, I'm going to honor that generation. Because they had a whole different mindset than we do today. Now, how many knows what I'm talking about? Why don't we just tell the truth? It was the truth. Let's tell truth for a change. My grandfather, you never had to worry about who was a preacher, whether he was going to steal from you. You didn't have to worry about these people. They were honorable people. You could leave your wallet with just about anybody in the 50s, and you knew they'd take care of your money. How many knows what I'm talking about? But today, because after World War II, this whole thing of, because we got so close to God. Do you understand what happened here? We got so close to God during World War II that the enemy could not have it. I will bring in humanism, I'll have this destroyed. And by the 1960s, it was a breeding ground of filth, was it not? Now, I'm a hippie at heart, so I don't mind that part, sorry. But what I'm saying is, you know, it's not bad to be a hippie, but it's bad to throw out God. I'm sorry. You've got to have Jesus, or this ain't going to work. You know, today people's got simple lives, but they don't want anything to do with God, and they wonder why it goes wrong. It will never go right. You have to have Jesus. You have to have Him. So when you're at a meeting, church, or anywhere you're at, all of us need to have this in our mind, that this is what worked before. You know, the greatest economy, I can't get off 1950, give me one more time. And do you know that was the greatest economy in history of all nations ever was the 50s. Did you guys know that? Think about what kind of people they were back then. They would literally, they said, now I did a lot of studies on this. I'm assuming this is true. I didn't live it. But they said you could literally, they would have houses on display and you could walk in there and say, hey man, I'd like to buy that house. They say, hey, what do you make? Well, this is, well, as long as you made that much a week, they would finance it instantly. Instantly. People cared about their neighbors. They cared about their friends. They cared about people that was sick. They cared about people that was cast down. They cared about if their kids were sick. They cared about if you went to church or not. They cared. They didn't love themselves. They loved each other. Wow, that's an awful idea. I wonder who came up with that. Could have been Jesus. They said, we need to love each other. But now they've programmed us. I'm not picking on anybody. Do you understand? I've done the same things. Okay, I'm not saying I'm better than you are. I'm not. Gosh, I'm the worst person in here. But we became lovers of ourselves because of deception. They sold us this, didn't they? This is what they said. They said, Mom and Dad don't need to be home. We'll raise them. Hey, don't you work. You guys go to work. Okay? While you're at work buying stuff you don't need, getting your kids' phones they don't need, I'm sorry. I'm going to make you mad. You need a $500 a month phone bill. Everybody in your family needs iPhone. Okay? That way, Mom's got to work. Dad's got to work. Nobody's home. And don't worry. The TV will raise your kids. Then you raise one day, you come home, and you don't know who your own kid is. And then the parents say, I've done something wrong. No, you didn't do anything wrong. The TV programmed them because they said we needed more. The average size of a house in 1950 was 1,000 to 1,200 square feet. That was the average size. Today, we'll have 2,000 square feet. I need to add on. I need more space. I need more room. I need a bigger car. In 1975, when my dad bought a truck, didn't even have radio. Had no bumper, had nothing. Today, I can't find a cheap truck. Doesn't exist. Why? Because we need all this stuff. Now, I've seen some of the men grinning. They're like, geez, it's unreal. It is. I don't want all this junk. What's wrong? Because we're programmed to have and want things that do not benefit us at all. Does not benefit us. But we threw God out the window. And now we're seeing the fruit of it. Now it's here. How many of us want to talk? We're seeing the fruit of this. So I ask you this week to be more easy on people that have addictive problems. And saying something to them, if you do not know the nature of super bad addiction, I'm not talking about light addiction. Heroin is absolutely, completely binding. One time, and you're strung out on it. One time. This is what people don't get. And you, by the third time, you physically have to have it. Physically, not mentally, physically. You can't live without it. You could die. And how did this come about? Why did my generation not want anything to do with this? I'm sure people my age have thought about this. Because our parents hammered that into your head. When I went to Sydney, I see all them shaking their head. I remember at school, we was like, oh, I'm never touching that. I don't care how outrageous we were. We was like, oh, I'm never touching that. Did you see that? Them guys were strung out first time. We'll never touch that. Boy, they had to get rid of those people, didn't they? Now we don't discuss that. Now we don't talk about that. And it's because we all worked together. And we knew these deceiving spirits was going to destroy our kids, destroy our grandkids. We were worried about this. But we're so worried about ourselves today that... So let us take a new direction. I got 30 seconds. Take a new direction. And let's realize that all of us praying together, this will work. This will work. Sister Karen hates it when I talk about my past, but I want to tell you something. In the 80s, I should have been dead. But Jesus Christ delivered me from who I was. And he can deliver those you know that are struggling in this area as well. Love them. Don't let them steal from you, because they will. But understand what you're dealing with. This is a spiritual warfare. That of people being deceived and being deceived. Are you with me? You sit around with a group of friends and they'll lead you to destruction. But with the knowledge of Christ kept me from death. Kept me from death. Me and a couple of buddies of mine, they were both raised in church. All three of us hung out together. And one time somebody blasphemed the Lord on a cassette we had. I think it was right after 8-Tracks was going out and we had a cassette. And we was putting it in there, and I remember my buddy looked at me and he said, "They're blaspheming God on that." And I said, "Man, give me that." We hit the tape and we threw it out the window. There was another guy there with us who didn't normally hang out with us. He tried to get out of the car to get that tape. My other buddy jumped out and busted it and said, "We will have nothing to do with you listening to that kind of filth." Now you're saying the wild child, because we were raised in church and because we were raised in the fear of God, we still had fear of God. Are you seeing what I'm saying? Church, your teachings that you've taught your kids and teaching them to do right, that they've not forgotten. I want you to be encouraged. I feel led to tell somebody this. You be encouraged. They've not forgotten these things. They do not forget the love you teach them. They do not forget to love God. They do not forget these things. I never forgot. It was screaming in my head all the time. But finally, the Spirit of the Lord showed up and he changed everything. And he can do it again. He can do it for our kids. He can do it for our grandkids. He can do it for our country. Amen? Amen. Why don't you stand, church?